How's everybody tonight?
Blessed,
highly flavored, anointed, appointed, refreshed. Are you refreshed and not refreshed? Praise God. Hallelujah. This is the night the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it because we have a choice. Turn to your neighbor, tell him you got a choice to rejoice. Because if you're miserable, stay home. And don't tell nobody you know Jesus until you're refreshed and you're joyful again. Because Jesus is not miserable. Amen?
Amen.
Glory! It's amazing how many people let the spirit of oppression take them over. Oppression is a killer, man. Oppression. People are oppressed. Jesus came to destroy the works of the enemy for those who are oppressed. Oppressed. Oppressed by who? The devil. He brings oppression. Amen?
Amen.
You know, oppression is associated with fear. Fear. Fear is one of the enemies that manipulates your will. Everyone say, fear,
fear.
Is my enemy.
That manipulates
my will.
My will.
What it does is it puts it in captivity. People's wills get put in captivity. They don't even know it's in captivity. They're just going around and doing all the religious things and have no idea that they're in captivity. Because one of the things the enemy does is put blinders back on people. Listen, we are in perilous times, man, but glorious times. Glorious. 2 Timothy 3. Sure wish it was the last seconds, but anyway. You know, there's a point in time where everything just is disgusting. It's like no matter where you turn, it's just stinking, dirty, and nasty, and unclean. But praise be to God. That's why we run to the throne and not to the phone. 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 1. We're going to speak this together, please. Is everybody there? But know this. Everyone say, know this. Look to your neighbor and say, know this.
Know
this. That in the last days, perilous times will come. Hello, are we in the last days?
Amen.
Then there's perilous times.
Amen.
Amen. Why? How is there going to be perilous times? Men will what? Be lovers of who? Themselves. That means they're going to stay in love with their old man. The old man is going to control them. The old man of wickedness that gets fed on sin. They're going to be lovers of themselves and lovers of money. Man, people do strange things for money. Hoo-wee. Eat worms and do all kinds of stuff. They will be boasters. They'll be proud. Arrogant, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, in other words, perverse mouth, without what? Self-control or control over self. Brutal. Brutal. Those are bullies. Despisers of good. Traitors. Headstrong. Haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. Why? Because they are disconnected. These people might have been connected. You got to remember, this letter, this epistle is written to believers, not unbelievers. So he's telling them, look at man, there's many that have been disconnected and those who have not even been connected. Because see, when you get connected, you have identity. When you're disconnected, you lose it. He said they will have a what? Form of godliness. In other words, some sort of a religious act, but it will deny the power. In other words, it won't be Christ-like. And from such people do what? Turn away, because you don't want to catch their cooties. Amen? You don't want to touch what they're touching. You stay away from them. Bad company corrupts good habits. Hello? Expose it. Rebuke it. You got a brother and sister acting like a retard? Rebuke it. And I don't mean sickness. I mean demonized, perverse, ugly, doing things that are not approving to God. Has everybody got it?
Amen.
Hallelujah. For this sort are those who what? Creep into households and make captives of gullible men and women, loaded down with sins, led away with various lusts. Lust, living under Satan's torment, L-U-S-T. Always learning. They're always going, yeah, I got it. Yeah, I got it, man. I got it. You ain't got nothing. Always learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Hello. In other words, they're not allowing, they're not putting the truth, they're not accepting it and using the truth. They go by, they are living individuals that live by emotion. Decisions of emotion. Decisions of circumstances. Decisions of fear. They become double-minded. Does everybody understand that? Double-mindedness is a sick mind. Does everybody understand that? It goes up and down, up and down. You can never trust them. One minute they're okay, the next minute they're... Pfft. That's double-mindedness. And where there's double-mindedness, there's dual personalities. And sometimes more. And a personality means that's a demon. Is everybody okay?
Amen.
Well, nobody ran out yet, so we're cool. Now, as Jannes and Jambres resisted Moses, so do these also resist the what? Truth. Men of what? Corrupt minds. Unstable. Disapprove concerning the what? Faith. They can't be still for nothing. Because they're never settled. They're easily offended. Offended. Offense. But they will progress no further. In other words, they can't grow. They stay in a cycle that just constantly repeats itself. Constantly repeats itself. Does everybody understand it? They progress. They will progress no further, for their folly will be manifested to all as theirs also was. But you have to what? Carefully follow the doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, love, and perseverance. Persecutions, afflictions, which happened to be at Antioch, at Iconium, at Lystrum. What persecutions I endured, not of them all. The Lord did what? He did what? He delivered me. How many know God delights in delivering his children? Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers them unto all of them. Yes, and all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. So listen, quit grumbling, complaining, and crying. And don't get offended. Fight through. You're to be a light in every area. Don't let every little thing move you out of position. Don't be a wimp. Fight. We're to be soldiers of the Most High. But evil men and what? And imposters will grow worse and worse, doing what? Deceiving and being deceived. But you must continue in the things which you have learned and been assured of, knowing from whom you have learned them, and that from childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures, which is able to make you what? Wise for what? Salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man or woman of God may be what? Complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. Every good work. See, if you are truly eating the Word of God, you won't be moved. That's the difference of those who listen and those who hear. Those who hear put it to effect. They accept, they believe, they receive, and they put it to action. But those who just listen are the ones that nod. Yeah, man, I got it. They ain't got nothing. didn't even receive it truly. They're just saying yes to please man or to even please themselves. But they really didn't accept it. The word tells us that when you don't receive the word of God with faith, it does nothing for you. Amen? So in these last days, perilous times will come. He talks about all of these individuals that are going to have spots and blemishes. Everyone say spots and blemishes. Do you ever, like, you'd be having a cup of coffee or something, you got this nice shirt on? And next thing you'd be drinking, and somebody said, man, what's the matter with you? You got a hole in your lip? And it's all over you. Oh, gosh. You get all upset because it's been blemished. It's got a spot on it. Amen? Has everybody got it? Or if you took something out of the dryer, right, and it looked like somebody tied it in a knot and threw it in the dryer and you pulled it out, it looked like, gosh, it's like, you know, it's all wrinkled. It may not have a spot or a blemish on it, but it is wrinkled, but it is noticeable. So everybody got it. And the Lord is sharing with us right now because there are many individuals that are walking around with spots, blemishes, and wrinkles. These are garments. They're called the garments of righteousness. And people bring it on themselves. And you know what? Let me share with you. When you have spots, blemishes, and wrinkles, that is a bullseye for the enemy. He's got you on radar. There he goes. Beep, beep. Sonar and radar. Why? Because sin attracts demonic forces. Sin attracts demonic forces. Everybody got that? Uncleanness attracts demonic forces. Unrighteousness attracts demonic forces. What comes out of your mouth can attract demonic forces. That's why the word says, come out from among them and do not what? Touch what is unclean. Why? Because then you're going to be spot, blemished, and wrinkled, and you're going to draw demonic forces. Has everybody got this? Psalm 119. Spots and blemishes, they're like snares on your garments and stains. Psalm 119. You know, many people, they try to clean their, they get all of the shouted out, you know, shout stuff to try to clean their garments. And you got to repent it out. Hello? People try to clean their own sin. Only the blood of Christ can cleanse them. It takes a humbleness. Everyone say humble. Humble. You must be humble, not prideful. Amen? Amen? God sets boundaries for all of us. When we do things out of God's time and extend boundaries, he's saying, you've done it on your own, not me. That's prideful and arrogance, isn't it? There's an order to everything, isn't there? Psalm 119. Is everybody there? In verse 1, would you speak it with me? Blessed are the what? Undefiled. Undefiled. So what's cursed? Those that are defiled. Amen. Those have spots and blemishes. Amen. Blessed are the undefiled in the way who do what? They walk in the law of the Lord. In other words, remember, whatever God speaks becomes law. Whatever God speaks is law. So they're saying they're walking according to what the word of God is and what he says. Blessed are those who keep his testimonies, who seek him with a whole heart. They also do no iniquity. Why? Because they seek him with a whole heart. There's relationship. There's connection. They walk in his ways. You have commanded us to keep your precepts diligently. Oh, that my ways were directed to keep your statutes. Then I would not be ashamed when I look into all of your commandments. I will praise you with uprightness of heart. When I learn your righteous judgments, I will keep your statutes. Oh, do not forsake me. How can a young man cleanse his ways? By what? Taking heed according to your word. Taking heed according to your word. With my whole heart I have sought you. Oh, let me not wander from your commandments. Your word I have hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you. Again, it's the word of God. If you're not in the word of God, you will become and maintain the association with sinning. So everybody got it. You just can't come to Bible studies. You must be in the word of God. Hallelujah. Verse 12. Blessed are you, O Lord. Teach me your statutes. With my lips I have declared all the judgments of your mouth. I have rejoiced in the way of your testimonies as much as in all riches. I will meditate on your precepts and contemplate your ways. I will delight myself in your statutes, and I will not forget your word. Blessed are the undefiled, those who are not defiled by the world of lust, sin, selfishness, greed, rebellion, and any other demonic influence. I'll repeat that. Blessed are those that are not defiled by the world of lust, sin, selfishness. I'm going to quiz everyone here, so make sure you write it all down. Why? Because paper don't forget, but you will. Lust, sin, selfishness, greed, rebellion, and any other demonic influence. Why? Because that's what brings spots and blemishes. The law is every word, every spoken word from God. He says, walk in the law or promises. You keep his testimonies. You seek him with a whole heart. You praise and worship him. You learn his judgments. Judgments that are associated with sowing and reaping. And you touch nothing unclean. How are you going to maintain that? By taking heed of his word and desire not to sin and desire to learn. Three things. You take heed to his word. You desire not to sin. And you desire to learn. Has everybody got that? Is everybody okay? 1 Peter chapter 1. First Pete 1, verse 3. Spots and blemishes. Let's speak it together, please. Verse 3. Blessed be the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. To an inheritance, what? Incorruptible and undefiled. So if you're undefiled, you access things that are undefiled. Amen? But if you're defiled, you have no access to them. You have none. You can't get to them. That does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through what? Faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by what? Various trials. There isn't one person that doesn't go through a trial or is in one. Amen. You're supposed to go through trials. So don't wimp out when you go through them. It says go through them. Remember, your trials and tribulations do two things. Expose your impurities and expose your enemy. Amen. It says that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ, whom having not seen you love, though now you do not see him, yet believing you rejoice with joy inexpressibly and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, the salvation of your souls. In other words, you have an inheritance that's incorruptible and undefiled. This means to those who are qualified, you must maintain an arena of qualification. This is what the enemy tries to do, is get you disqualified. Why? If he can get you to start touching unclean things and contaminated things that defile you, it causes you disconnect and disqualification. Again, your eternal inheritance is undefiled. Has everybody got it? It's undefiled. Everyone say undefiled. It's holy. It's righteous. This is your inheritance. To get to it, you must become what your inheritance is. Various trials and attacks by the enemy. What's he trying to do? Provoke the undefiled, those who are clean and upright, to become defiled. Amen? Why? By attacking them so that he can disconnect them from faith and from their identity. Again, I'm always going to go back to identity because one of the things the enemy wants to do is never allow you to know who you are. Or once you know who you are, disconnect you from who you are. James 1. Verse 21. Now these are things he begins to speak on that he says will bring spots and blemishes. Ooh. I like this right here. We're going to start at verse 19. I will start at 18. Some things just don't change. Are you ready? Of his own will he brought us forth by what? The word of truth. That's how you came. That we might be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. So then, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to what? Hear. He didn't say listen. He said what? Hear. And slow to speak. Too many people speak before they hear. In fact, they speak so much, they can't hear. And slow to wrath. For the wrath of man does not produce the righteousness of God, but it brings an individual to become defiled. Therefore, lay aside all what? Filthiness, which will bring a spot or a blemish, won't it? An overflow of wickedness. Receive with meekness the implanted word which is able to save your souls. But be what? Doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourself. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he's an idiot. He is like a man observing his natural face in the mirror. For he observes himself, goes away, and immediately forgets what kind of man he was. In other words, he forgets his identity. He loses it. But he who looks into the perfect law of liberty and does what? Continues in it and is not a forgetful hearer. He puts it to work. But not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work. This one will be what? Blessed in what he does. If anyone of you thinks he's religious or connected and doesn't bridle his tongue, hello, he deceives his own heart. Why? Because your tongue was one of the things that will disconnect you and bring spots and blemishes. This one's religion is useless. In other words, their relationship is useless. Pure and undefiled religion or connection, relationship before God and the Father is this, that you visit orphans and widows in their trouble, but do what? Keep what? Oneself unspotted. Unspotted from the world. Why? Because if you're spotted and you have blemishes, it's going to bring defilement or contamination. And the process of keeping those on you is going to bring disconnect. Disconnect. Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians 5. 25. It says, husband, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of the water by the word, that he might present her to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. Now, he's talking about the body of Christ. Does everybody understand that? So husbands ought to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as the Lord does the church. For we are members of his body, of his flesh, and of his bones. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. Nevertheless, let each one of you in particular so love his own wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband. In other words, the mystery of the church is Christ and his bride. It says that the bride should respect the husband. In other words, you and I are to honor, respect. Does everybody got it? And reverence the Lord. It's called the fear of the Lord. Is honor, respect, and reverence. Honor, respect, and reverence is called the fear of the Lord. And it says, because he loves us unconditionally, doesn't he? So we're to be a bride without spot or wrinkle or blemish. Why? Because those things will interrupt your relationship and eventually bring you disconnect. Does everybody understand that? See, too many people take spots and blemishes nonchalantly, touching unclean things, just thinking it's okay. God knows my heart. Yes, he knows you're an idiot. He knows you're deceived. Amen? He's trying to bring it to you to stop dropping those things that defile yourself. In fact, the word says, if you defile your temple, God will what? Destroy it. Titus 1. Titus, in other words, there isn't enough people taking this serious. You know, most people think, well, man, I'm okay. I'm just doing this. Well, just doing this ain't okay. Why don't he lie on weekends? That ain't okay. Verse 10. This is how the Lord looks at these things. He said, for there are many what? Insubordinate, but idle talkers and deceivers, especially those of the circumcision, whose mouths must be stopped, who subvert whole households, teaching things which they ought not for the sake of dishonest gain. One of them, a prophet of their own, says, Cretans are always liars, evil beasts, lazy gluttons. This testimony is true. Therefore, rebuke them sharply that they may be of sound in faith, not giving heed to Jewish fables and commandments of men who turn from the truth. Who turn from the truth. To the pure, all things are pure. But to those who are defiled and unbelieving, how many of y'all know that unbelief will defile you? Unbelief will defile you. Well, I just don't believe that. Well, you're defiled. Anything that you don't believe in this word will defile you. Will put a spot and blemish on you. To the pure, all things are pure, but to those who are defiled and unbelieving, nothing is pure. But even their mind and their conscience are defiled. In other words, the word conscience means awareness. So their awareness is very dull. They can't even recognize things. It says they profess to know God, But in their fruits or their acts or their works, they deny him. Being abominable, disobedient, and disqualified for every good work. Wow. Defiled in unbelief. Say they know, but in works or, in other words, they're disobedient, aren't they, to the word. They deny him in that arena. 2 Peter 2. Is everybody okay? You know, the word says that the way is narrow. Amen? The path is narrow. But the way of wicked is wide and broad, isn't it? Well, I want you to know that God is. In fact, there's coming a time when you're going to have to step sideways. Things are tightening up, man. So when someone says tighten up, means like cut loose of the garbage. Tighten up, homie. Before you come homeless. Second Peter 2, 12. Glory. But these, like natural brute beasts, made to be what? Caught and destroyed, speak evil of things they don't understand. That I see that happen all the time. People speak evil of things they don't understand, especially when it comes out of gifts of the spirits or laying on hands. That ain't God. That's evil. And then they sound evil themselves, you know. Of course, you can't give what you ain't got. So if you've never been baptized in the Holy Spirit, speaking in tongues, the devil's going to easily use you. Amen. What's he going to do? Come against it. He keep you in a state of religiosity. But speak evil of things they do not understand and will utterly perish in their own corruption. And will receive the wages of unrighteousness as those who count it pleasure to carouse in the daytime. They are what? Spots and blemishes, carousing in their own deception. It's like they're walking in their own puddle all day long, the puddle of deception. They are spots and blemishes, carousing in their own deception while they feast with you. Oh, yeah, they have good time with you. They're sitting with you, man. But in their hearts and their minds, they're out there. Verse 14, having their eyes full of adultery that cannot cease from sin, enticing unstable souls. They have a heart trained in covetous practices and are accursed children. They are what? They are accursed children. Snap. Nice. Carouse in their own deceptions. In other words, they're controlled by demonic forces because they're carousing in their own deception. They don't even know it. They're controlled by demonic forces. These are demons and demonic beings that's in their soul. And don't just because you're a Christian doesn't mean a devil can't possess a part of your members because you don't have control over it. Someone does. And these demons will use individuals to penetrate the body of Christ with compromise, with doubt, with unbelief. They cause division. And they try to enlarge the door of demonic influence. And they love to steal your identity. And Jude, don't start singing. Amen. Jude, verse 11. Whoa! Means without eternity. Whoa! To them. For they have gone in the way of Cain and have run what? Greedily. Greedy. How many of y'all know that greediness will defile your garments? that will bring a spot and blemish. How many, you know, think about how many people cheat God from tithe and offering and not even know that they're dotted. They're dotted. I mean, there's dots all over them, spots and blemishes. Because they cheat God of tithes and offerings. They give what they feel instead of what God requires. That means they're living out of their own will, and their will has been taken captive. They have run greedily in the air of Balaam for profit and perish in the rebellion of Korah. These are what? Spots in your love feast while they feast with you without fear. In other words, fear of God, reverence, honor, and respect. Serving only who? Serving only who? Serving only who?
Themselves.
They are clouds without water carried about by the winds, late autumn trees without fruit, twice dead, pulled up by the roots, raging waves of the sea, foaming up their own shame, wandering stars for whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. Snap. Touched by greed, servants of self, returning to offsprings of Satan and leaving the counsel of the Lord by compromising, bringing spots and blemishes of ungodliness through rebellion and disobedience. I guess I better repeat that. Because of the touching of greediness, they become servants of self. They return to offsprings of Satan, leaving the counsel of the Lord by compromising, and they become spots and blemishes of ungodliness with rebellion and disobedience. Psalm 36. Psalm 36. You know, some people are more concerned in how they look with clothes than they how God sees them on their garments. Remember, the word says you can't, or not the word says, but anyways, have you ever heard you can't judge the book by its cover? It could be real pretty, but inside it can be really nasty. Psalm 36 and verse 1. Let's speak it. An oracle within my heart concerning the transgression of the wicked. And what is the first thing he says? This is the fruit of wickedness. There is what? There is no fear of God before his eyes. There is no reverence, honor, and respect. You can be guaranteed that person is disconnected and still looking for an identity. For he flatters himself with his own eyes when he finds out his iniquity and when he hates. The words of his mouth are wickedness and deceit. In other words, he has a perverse mouth. And he has ceased to be wise and do good. He deceives, he devises wickedness on his bed, and he sets himself in a way that is not good. He does not hate or abhor evil. He doesn't hate evil. In other words, he approves of it. He may not speak it, but he still approves of it. Because you know what he would do? Depart from evil. If you do not hate evil, you won't depart from it. Amen? In other words, here's the arena of wickedness. They've lost the fear of God. They become bitter. They become resentful, unforgiving, resulting in ungodly thoughts, a wicked mouth, and approving ungodliness. Why? Because they don't hate evil. Because why? They don't hate evil. Anyone who doesn't hate evil is wicked. Hebrew 12. Now that would be really cool if the Lord really showed everybody's spots and blemishes, wouldn't it? See a bunch of people walking around with purple polka dots and stuff like that. Black pot dots and all blemishes, wrinkled clothes. They probably have the right shoe on the left foot. Hallelujah. Hebrew 12. Verse 12. Therefore do what? Strengthen the hands which hang down and the feeble knees. Make straight paths for your feet so that what is lame may not be dislocated or disconnected, but rather be what? Healed and connected. In other words, when you see someone beginning to fall in this arena where they're becoming blemished and spotted, warn them. Amen? Warn them. When they're touching unclean things, warn them. If you've done, you do what you do, then God will take care of the rest, believe me. It says, pursue peace with all people and holiness without what? Which no one will see the Lord. Looking carefully, lest anyone fall short of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness. Does bitterness bring a spot? Yeah. Springing up cause trouble, and by this many become what? Defiled. Lest there be in any a fornicator or profane person like Esau. Now Esau sold his identity. He sold his birthright for things of the world. Who for one morsel of food sold his what? Birthright. For you know that afterward when he wanted to inherit the blessing, hello, he was what? Rejected, because he didn't do it with true repentance. For he found no place for what? Repentance. Though he sought it diligently with tears. He cried, but never repented. Is everybody okay? Oh, hallelujah. Strengthen those who have become weak with spots and blemishes. In other words, warn them so they don't fall deeper into complete disconnect and losing their identity, becoming offsprings and serving darkness like Esau. Ezekiel 20. Glory. Ezekiel chapter 21. Ezekiel 21, verse 6. Oh, snap. That's 20, I'm sorry. Ezekiel 20. Hey, it's only one chapter back. Ezekiel chapter 20 in verse 1. Is everybody there? Amen. On that day I raised my hand and an oath to them, says the Lord, to bring them out of the land of Egypt. How many know land means, Egypt means bondage? In other words, you were called out of the world. You were pulled out of the world. God chose you and pulled you out of the world. Amen? Is everybody there? Verse 6. Into a land that I have searched out for them, flowing with milk and honey, the glory of all lands. In other words, God pulled you out of darkness. He pulled you out of bondage so that you can walk in the promises of God and enter the eternal realm. Then I said to them, each of you, throw away the abominations which are before your what? Eyes. And do not defy yourself with what? Idols of Egypt. I am the Lord your God. But they rebelled against me and would not obey me. They did not cast away the abominations which were before their eyes, nor did they forsake the idols of Egypt. Then I said, I will pour out my fury on them and fulfill my anger against them in the midst of the land of Egypt. But I acted for my name's sake, that it should not be profaned before the Gentiles among whom they were, in whose sight I had made myself known to them to bring them out of the land of Egypt. Therefore, I made them go out of the land of Egypt and brought them into where? The wilderness. And I gave them my statutes and showed them my judgments, which if a man does, he will live by them. So what happens? People go into where? The wilderness. Dry land. Dry land. It's a self-imposed judgment from God. They go into dry land. They end up in the wilderness. And if they stay in there long enough, they get disconnected and possessed. Is everybody okay? Revelation 21. Oh, the devil likes to get you dry. He likes to drain you. Get you dry. How many know something that's filled with liquid is heavier than something that's dried up? Amen? Revelation 21, verse 6. Spots and blemishes. Is everybody there? And he said to me, it's done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, and I will give of the fountain of the water of life freely to him who what? Thirst. He who overcomes shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. But the cowardly, those are fear. Those are people who live according to fear. They're called cowards. Unbelieving. See, it all starts with fear. Many things to remember. Satan's greatest weapon is deception, and his power is fear. If he can get a person in fear, he can get him to unbelief. Then he can get him to do all kinds of other things. But the cowardly, unbelieving, abominable, murderers, sexual immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars shall not have their power, shall have their part in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the what? Second death. Why? Because they are blemished and spotted, aren't they? Does everybody see this? Fear alters the will to unbelief. Does everybody got that? What it does is it allows an individual to, in reaching another level of spots, blemishes, and wrinkles, until final disconnect. And one thing you don't want to do is when the Lord shows up is be disconnected. Or when he calls you home. Amen. Now I'm going to close at Revelation 3. And to the angel of the church, Sardius write, these things says he who has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know your works and your fruits, that you have a name, that you are alive, but you are dead. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die. For I have not found your works or your fruits, what? Perfect before God. Remember, therefore, how you have received and heard. Hold fast and do what? Repent, which means to what? Turn away. Depart from evil. Therefore, if you will not watch, I will come upon you as a thief. And you will not know what hour I will come upon you. You have a few names, even in Sardis, who have not defiled their garments. And they will walk with me in white, for they are what? Worthy. In other words, they are qualified. He who overcomes shall be clothed in white garments, and I will not blot out his name from the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. And he who has an ear, let him hear. Believe, receive, and execute. Why? Because we've been warned. There isn't one person in here now that doesn't have an excuse. Amen? And anyone who listens to this, who's watching, nobody has an excuse. You don't have to go home to wait to be judged. God is judging you right now. We are always He's always before us, isn't he? What are you going to do with it? That's what he wants to know. What are you going to do with what he just spoke to you? Amen? Father, we thank you for your word. We are honored and blessed. Lord, we repent for any areas of spots and blemishes and wrinkles. Help us to hate evil and love righteousness. Help us to expose the wickedness and depart from evil. Help us to say yes to you and no to evil influence. And keep us, Lord. Keep us in a place of self-examination, that you may always be before us, that we may be sensitive to your voice and to your conviction, to your counsel and to your correction, that we may be sons and daughters that are worthy to be called your sons and daughters. Lord, have mercy upon us and let your grace abound to each and every one here. In Jesus' name. And everybody said amen.
Amen.
Be blessed and stay dressed with the glory.